Praise the Lord. You know, God addresses men on mountains. So if you don't ascend, you can't hear the voice of God. The oracles of God, they are in elevated platforms. That's why we take advantage of vehicles of spiritual transport. I didn't come with a message. My message is in heaven. If the tablets of the testimonies are not open to you, you'll be an orator and you can't move a generation forward. The secrets of God, the Bible said, is with them that fear him, and he will show them his covenants. So when we come before God, what he does is that he opens his oracles to us and we discern his movements. That's when we bless men. So you reign, you ancient Zion's king, Kadosh, Kadosh. You are mighty on your throne. You reign, you ancient Zion's king, Kadosh, Kadosh. You are mighty on your throne. Break forth, O fountains of the deep, cry out, Kadosh. You are mighty on your throne. You know, there is a stirring in the heart of men at this time. The reason is because God has an agenda, and this is a strategic moment in the calendar of the divine. Wise men are not men that are well studied. They are men that can peep into the spirit and discern the vibrations of God. And when you discern the movement of the spirit called Elohim, the greatest wisdom that you sustain is to align. It's when that alignment pattern is sustained that you become relevant in your generation. What we attempt to do this morning is to align with the frequencies of God. Most of you have read books. You have read and you have followed men. But do you know the vibrations of God? Have you peeped into the heavens and you know what God is doing now? Have you adjusted yourself to align with the marching orders of the Spirit? If you haven't, then there is a trumpet in the Spirit. He said, blow the trumpet in Zion. Sound an alarm upon his holy mountain, that the habitations, the inhabitants will know. Ah. You know, in the last 20 days, I have spoken directly one-on-one to more than 30,000 youths. I've been ministering back to back. It's because of the urgency of the Spirit. On the 17th, I was in Warri, ministering to close to 2,000 young people. On the 18th to 20th, I was in Ghana, ministering to close to 5,000 young people. On the 27th, I was in Akure, ministering to close to 4,000 young people. On the 28th, I was in Kano, ministering to close to 3,000 young people. On the 29th and 30th, I was at the Redemption Camp, ministering to close to 16,000 young people. On the 2nd and 3rd, I was in Kogi State, ministering to close to 1,500 young people. And there are over 400 to 500 young people here. It's to tell you what God is doing. And many are pressing into God. There are many young people crying for encounters. There are many young people pressing into God because this is the season. You can't be left out. You can't be left out. There's an alarm in the spirit. What will happen in the next 40 years if Jesus tarries is dependent on what you do now. Not every moment is the same. He said at a certain time, the angel of the Lord went down and troubled the water. A man waited for 38 years because he missed the moments of the Spirit. You may be irrelevant for 40 years because you missed the stirring of the waters. And listen, I'm seeing a vision. Somebody is being given a cup of wine. Listen. You know, the way God is so urgent upon humans now is strange. The moment you lift your hand, something begins to happen. The urgency in the spirit is not because men of God are necessarily powerful. There is a move of the spirit. Listen. If you are a young lady, just put your hand on your top. I'm seeing a vision. Somebody is being given a drink, a cup of wine in the spirit. Now you will drink it. Most times it's not a message you need. What you need is a spiritual experience. It's an encounter, it's a touch. It will turn your life around. He said, as you depart from me, you will meet a band of prophets, and the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you, and you will be changed into another man. Father, in the name of Jesus, everyone in this auditorium and outside that you are serving a drink of a fresh wine, the wine that stewards alignment, Holy Ghost, there are three of them that you are making special messengers. Father, from the left to the right, from the front to the back, to the auditorium outside, touch, drink of the new wine. I bring you the ceremony of alignment. I come to you by the spirit of an endless priesthood, and I say, enter into new dimensions of the spirit. Barakina Barakavak Satavinda Tetatalish Barienda Sivak Senelina Baraka. The voice of God is upon many waters. The voice of God, it thundereth, it breaketh the cedars, it causes the hinds to calve, it divided the flames of fire. And that voice comes to your spirit now. Barakela Variana Taba. The lionesses, the greatest of hunters, I call you forth. I speak over the waters of your spirit, and I say, break forth. Barakila Baragabak. Barak. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Holy Ghost. The movement has begun. The movement has begun. It's not necessarily about the teaching. It's always about an encounter. That we may look upon him as he is. Because when we see him, we shall be like him. When we see him, that's when transformation takes place. The oracles of God opens to us this morning. Lord, the voice of the younger generation ascend to your holy mountains. Fall upon us. We make demand for dimensions unseen. We make demand for virgin dimensions in God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Listen. I didn't come to minister in the spirit this morning. But when God begins to move, His wisdom is superior to our understanding. Something is about to happen in this auditorium now. I'm seeing, listen, please pay attention. I'm seeing a liquid fire, and it's flowing, and it's burning everything on its path, breaking barriers and moving. And I inquired of the Lord, I said, what is this? He said, a generation is rising from the east with a fire that cannot be contested. You know, the man from the east naturally carries the spirit of revival, because the eastern man violates the requirement of territory. There's no territory where he cannot take over. He's like a Chinese man. You can't stop him. Anywhere you don't see him, the mortars don't live there. Run. If you go to a place and you don't see a man from the east, run from there. Human beings are not supposed to live there. They carry the DNA of revival. And as I speak, the grace for speed. Listen, I know you have been powered in that fellowship for 5 years and it has not moved forward. I know you have been praying for 10 years and it has not moved forward. I know you've been doing that business for 7 years and it has not moved forward. But right now, the grace for speed is coming upon someone. That anointing will hit this auditorium. Some of you will start running. Some of you will literally, the force will throw you. The force is a grace for speed. And I stretch my hand over you and I release that dimension. Enter, 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 enter. Enter, 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 enter. Baki barakabak. Go forward. I'm seeing the power of God fall on a young lady outside. She's wearing a black gown. The power of God is falling on someone outside. This one's with prophesy. She will prophesy. She's wearing a black gown. The power of God is falling on a young lady. She's outside. She's wearing a black dress. She will begin to prophesy. Is there somebody like that outside? See the hand of God. Bring the lady for me. Want to lay my hands on her. She will profess her. Hanasi hallelujah. Hanasi hallelujah. Jehovah Omeri wo. Omeri wo. Dimosi mini wo. Hanasi hallelujah. Hanasi hallelujah. Jehovah Omeri wo. You will never remain the same again. Enter! All your life. you will prophesy. For you have been made a herald of the move of God. attempt to do a teaching for 30 minutes. Nothing happens by chance. Everything we see is an orchestration from the realm of the spirit. One of the greatest manifestations of the architectural intelligence of God is the ability to crystallize the visible realm from the invisible realm. God dwelt in himself for aeons, because before anything was, Elohim was. Because he's the one who was, who is, and who is to come. And before even the spirit realm existed, Yahweh was. The first revelation that the existence of God grants is the fact that he cannot be known except he chooses to reveal himself. Because your first attempt to contemplate this divine oracle will reveal to you the insufficiency of the mind. Because how can you be when there is nowhere to be? It is impossible to exist except there is a sphere. Because when God began creation, the sequence and the protocol of creation is that you create the environment before you create the species. That revelation in itself shows us that creation is in a different class from God. Because for creation to exist, the environment was designed before the species was designed. But in the case of God, God existed before his environment. He said, in the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. The heavens in plural, because the spirit realm predates the natural. There was an ageless civilization that existed in the spirit realm before the natural was crystallized. God didn't begin with man. Man is one of the many projects that he inculcated into the cycles of eternity. And when this project, God man, is over, Elohim is still existing. Because he's the one who was, who is, and who is to come. He is an unending and a perpetual continuum. And the civilization that existed before man was a civilization of spirits. Because the first might that God displayed in creation was not visible. It was invincible. Because God is spirit. So he began creation in a dimension that was consistent to his reality. And he fabricated the spirit realm. And he created spirit beings and put them in that realm. You know, if you were told how the angels were created, you can't bear it. Some of the patriarchs that were granted encounters into the foundation, you know, earth is governed by time, space, and matter. Eternity is governed by reality. If I step into eternity like this and come out, where I entered maybe 100 years into the past. So you don't travel in eternity from one location to another. You travel in eternity from one reality.
to another is a migration. That's why I say when the Spirit of Truth is come, He won't guide you from place to place. He will guide you into all reality, from reality to reality. The same step I took into eternity and brought back, if I take that same step again and come back, I may go into 200 years into the future. I was doing the same thing, the same distance, but I was touching different realities. So when He began the project of creation, He created the spirit realm to sustain the texture and the dimension that was consistent to His essence. And you know, in that realm, only kings exist. So the beings that He created had thrones. And since He was the only essence of that reality, everything He created there mirrored His dimension. So even the atmosphere of the spirit realm is a symphony of God. If you enter into the spirit realm, when you breathe God. You don't breathe oxygen, you breathe the presence. So everything you do in eternity is worship. Because worship is not a song. Worship is a posture in the spirit that releases the essence of God from within you. That's why even when you are singing, there is an essence of God you can't release until you hit the note. So sometimes you have to bend before you can release that note. Sometimes you will need to lie down before that note can come, because the depth of God that you are about to release is a dimension that is in the deep waters. And until your heart bows, you can't draw that essence and release it. So the creatures of heaven that dwells in the regions of the Shamayim, everything they do is worship. When they breathe God. Because the atmosphere is the presence, the many dimensions of God. If you get to heaven, some of the things you see are mountains. But the mountains of heaven are not elevated platforms. They are realms of authority. So when you ascend mountains in the spirit, you are coming to higher realms of authority, and you will discover that the energy of God in that realm is superior. So sometimes when you approach, you begin to dematerialize. You can't come close unless maybe the cherubims begin to shield you with their wings. That's why in the Holy of Holies, the wings of the cherubims extend from one end to another, is to shield you from the energy and the magnitude of God when the Shekinah appears. So everything in heaven was a revelation of God. And one of the creatures of heaven became foolish, because he thought he was like God. That you look like doesn't mean you are like. All you see is not all there is. All you see is all that is revealed. There is more than all that is revealed. And when God saw the foolishness, God decided to carry out another storm. And what he did was that he said, since I created everything to be spirit, and you think I am limited by spirit, let me show you something again. So God traveled back into himself. Elohim Adonai. You know, there was a day after fasting and praying for a long time, I laid on my bed. I was tired. And suddenly, the wall, light appeared on the wall, and someone came out of the wall. And he stood before me. He was an ancient man. And when he began to talk, his voice was like thunder. And fear. You know, people want encounters. If you see some encounters, you have heart failure. There was a day I was praying in the room, and as I lifted my head, I saw a red fire. I fell asleep. God with fear. He can kill you. And the problem is, when you die, you don't die, you translate. Because they just don't die. They translate into a higher reality. But I don't want to translate yet. And the elder, as he spoke to me, my spirit came out of my body. And as he was talking, the scriptures were opening. And they were entering into my spirit. I now discovered every scripture is a gate. Every scripture is a portal. So when we use words portal, we don't want, it's not talk. It is the access we have per time. So we don't say what we thought about. We say because there's a disclosure. And when God wanted to dwarf the intelligence of the angelic realm, he now went back into himself. You know, what the angels did not know was that he is not just existing, he is existence. So he was before their realm was framed. And everything that can be obtainable in their realm came from within him. So he traveled to a place in himself that no angel has ever reached. And what was there was a wisdom to crystallize tangible material from intangible. Was to crystallize visible reality from invincible reality. And he didn't tell them anything. He came and he framed the world. Because he said the world was framed by the word of his power, so that the things which are were not made out of the things that do appear. And when he finished it, he now invited the angels to the ceremony. And when the angels came, the only thing they could do was to sing for joy. So in Job 38 from verse 7, he said, when he laid the foundations of the earth, the angels sang for joy. They were dwarfed. Who is this? What is this? And he decided not to go into himself alone now. He fetched from the dust that he created, and he buried himself inside the dust. I will remain unseen. But now, since you think spirit is so powerful, dust will be the one to manifest my glory. So when you see dust, you see God. You know, Lucifer was decked with beauty and glory, and he thought everything was about the light that came out of him. So God didn't choose to showcase light anymore. He buried it in dust. So the same dust that you don't know the origin, because the dust is not part of the spirit realm. In all of the lexicon of the spirit realm, you will never find anything called dust, because materiality did not exist in immateriality. It was a mystery in God. So this mystery called materiality, I will hide myself in it so you can't understand me. When you want to understand me, you will see terrible dimensions that you have not seen in the spirit realm inside dust. So he said, even the principalities and powers, Ephesians 3:10, they look upon mortals, the church, to learn the exceeding wisdom of God. So the greatest asset of man is not money. The greatest asset of man is not a car. The greatest asset of man is not a man connection. The greatest asset of man is God. You know, when we talk the kingdom, we have moved to a place where only God is desired. Only God is seen. Only God is known. The kingdom is not for babes. It's for those who are willing to do business in deep waters. They have died to everything that man boasts with. We will preach, but we may never know the kingdom unless God becomes priority. So when Jesus lived with this man, he carried them until he brought them to a point where he was their only obsession. And then he said, go into all the world and disciple the nations. What is the discipleship? Is to teach them how to come to that same place where you have come, where only God matters. The mandate is a calling to a place where only God counts. Go into all the world and disciple all nations. But you see, it happens to be that before you bring men into the kingdom, you have to take them through the elementary route. The elementary route is what God gives. But when God makes you, God doesn't give you anymore. You become the one that gives what God gives, because you become one with God. We have over 1 million Christians, and every time they come to church is to receive bread. And the bread makers are few, because only few know the kingdom. So they didn't help you if from January to December all you receive is prophecy. They helped you when they begin to teach you the secrets of the kingdom. So the things you come to receive, you begin to manufacture. But most times, even the men of God are afraid, because they think if men begin to manifest, they will leave them. And we have a generation of babes and dwarfs. The man who taught me the kingdom, I am perpetually indebted to him, no matter what happens. 99% of my message has the name of Apostle Arume on it. Men don't become ungrateful when they learn truth. They become eternally grateful. You know, the body of Christ is so infantile that when you want to talk kingdom, you will receive two responses. The first is that they tell you, this is not the gospel. The gospel is preaching Jesus. They don't know Jesus. Because Jesus is not only a man that died on the cross. Jesus is the government of God. Jesus is the systems of God. All things were made by him. Without him was not anything made that was made. He said in Ephesians 1:10 that at the end of all things,
God will gather all that is in heaven and on earth, and even heaven and earth, and he will put it in Christ. So earth and heaven will enter Christ. The laws of God, the ways of God, is Christ. He is all things that God has to offer. So in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8, verse 5, he said, and Philip went to Samaria. He preached Christ there, and the city was full of joy. Acts 8, verse 5. Philip went to Samaria. He preached Christ there. The city was full of joy. And he went further. And he showed them what God gives. He said, when they saw demons crying out of people and the lame walking, they believed. That's where some people's gospel end. They say, we preach Christ and him crucified. When Paul began, he preached Christ and him crucified. When he finished, he said, I have preached unto you the kingdom of God. In verse 12 of this same scripture, Philip discovered when they learned that their sins were forgiven, when they learned that demons were cast out, he said, they kept their ways in darkness. He said, there was one Simon, a sorcerer. What did he do? Himself was full of joy when he heard about Christ, but he kept his ways. That's why you will tell people about Jesus. All they think is what Jesus can give, because Christ and him crucified is all Jesus can give. You have not been discipled, because the day that God needs men, you will not be numbered. Because you will still think your money is your God. So you will worship God except when they want to touch your money. You will worship God except when they want to touch your business. So all your meetings in the East begins very late in the night, because everybody must close from business before it comes for meeting. If the meeting is 4 o'clock, nobody can come, because 4 to 6, there is still some money that must be made. Even if Jesus is standing on the altar, they will come by 8. We are babes. We don't know kingdom. If you see a crowd gather, then the man is prophesying. And all the testimonies, last week they prophesied, I got a car. Last week they prophesied, my business book. That is beautiful. If only it becomes a stool for advancing kingdom. But if it becomes your God, you are a slave. So Simon kept his ways, and he was still a dark sorcerer. And when Philip saw that Christ and him crucified is not enough, in Acts chapter 8 verse 12, Philip changed the syllabus. And see what Philip preached. But when they believed, the job of Christ and him crucified ends when they believe. When you teach people Christ and him crucified, that is the end. They believe. But when they believe, that's when kingdom begins. That's why I said, except a man be born again, he can't see the kingdom. Kingdom begins when they believe. What brings you to the point of believing? Christ and him crucified. So if I want to talk to you about divine healing, I won't only teach you, I will pray for you to be healed. That's Christ and him crucified. Then you will believe. If I want to teach you about prosperity, I won't only talk about it, I will impart the grace. Then you will believe. But he said, when they believed, then we begin kingdom. Do you know what God does? When you come to God and you say, Lord, look at me, help me, God will graciously help you. and you will receive a prophetic word and become a millionaire. But when you get that million, God will now come back and tell you, we want to go for evangelism. We need 500,000. Because the money he gave you is not for you. You are a divine trust fund. But if you don't know kingdom, and all you know is Christ and him crucified, you will use God as your ATM machine. And when God comes to you, you'll be nowhere to be found. I will show you the consequence of not walking in the kingdom. He said, when they believed, Philip began to teach them things pertaining to the kingdom. That's why he said, go into all the world and disciple all nations. He didn't say, just tell them about me and get them to believe. He said, disciple them. In Acts chapter 1, verse 2 and 3, those who followed Jesus, they saw him resurrected. That is the end of Christ and him crucified. You have entered into the economy of the resurrection. That means you don't live by circumstance, you live by God. Because the resurrection power is the testimony of the defeat over the grave. The resurrection power is where prosperity hangs, is where healing hinges, is where everything God has to offer hinges. They saw him resurrect. And then the resurrected one came to them. Acts 1 verse 2 and 3. And he said, until the day which he was taken up to heaven, after through the Holy Ghost, he gave them commandment to the apostles whom he had chosen. What was he telling them? To whom he also presented himself alive. This is the end product of Christ and him crucified. To paint him to have resurrected so that you will believe. He said, oh foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Have you begun in the spirit and you attempt to be perfected in the flesh? He said, before you, whom Christ was evidently crucified. But he said, after Jesus presented himself alive by many infallible proofs, being seen of them during 40 days and speaking. So, when you journey from Christ and him crucified, you come into kingdom. Speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. The reason we are not strong is because all our encounters and walk with God ends where we can receive from him. When God needs men, he can find us. And even when we give, we come to do business with God. We give only to receive. Because we know not the kingdom. So he said, go into all the world and disciple all nations. What is the discipleship? Is to expose them to the government of God. Bring them into the kingdom so that they can participate in the kingdom. This morning, and we'll pray. I know all of you here believe in Jesus, but what I don't know is if all of you here are in the kingdom. Because if God makes a demand now for money to sponsor evangelism, I don't know how many can part with their money. The subject of the kingdom is not a doctrine. Is life. Is experiential. If God says he needs men now, in the west, in the north, I don't know how many can go. So I know almost all of you have accepted Jesus. But I don't know how many are in the kingdom. But just in case you say you are in the kingdom, I want to bring out 3 acid test to verify. And if by any means we are not there, then we will take time to pray and ask God to help. You ancient Zion's King, Kadosh, Kadosh, you are mighty on your throne. Break forth, all fountains of the deep,
cry out, Kadosh, you are mighty on your throne.
The first test is the love test. Do you love the Lord? What does it mean to love His Spirit? That's the first question. I know most of us go to pray, and when we pray at 12 midnight, we pull our clothes and we are naked. And we say, Lord, what does it mean to love His Spirit? I know most of us, when we want to pray, we lie down and we are crying. We roll on the floor to show how much we love God. Well done, sir. When you finish, stand up and find out what the Bible calls love. You know, Jesus is the wisdom of God. So when Jesus speaks, He speaks wisdom that exists before the foundation of the world. You can't vet it in the university. It's a waste of time. What He says is what He is. And He's the one who was, who is, and who is to come. And two ways Jesus says to love Him. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. He didn't say, if you love me, cry. He didn't even say, if you love me, tell me. I know those who love me by observing, not by hearing. Lord, I love you. Lord, I love you. Okay, if you do, let's check. He said, where a man's treasure is, there his heart is. Your heart is not in church because you came into an auditorium. You can be in an auditorium, but you still be in your shop in the Shamin Market. How much did he say? No. 1.2 million. 1.2 million. No, it can't be 1 million. Amen, 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 amen. When you see the brother pray, and you come close, let's join faith together. God is helping the brother. You will say, oh boy, the business is not working. It must work. There's nothing wrong with the prayer. But when the business work, will your knees still be on the ground? You see the sister mopping the church Monday to Saturday. Wait until she gets married. So what she's doing, she's bargaining for a husband with God. We are shallow and we are earthly. So when God looks at us, He wonders if we know what is in the Spirit. That's why I began by telling you, your greatest asset is God. Does it mean any of these things is wrong? No. But if your movement and your journey in God stops there, then you are a failure. And just in case your heart is not with God, just in case you can't keep His commandment, He has given the verdict. You know, it's not in heaven you will discover. By the scripture, we know a lot of things on earth. A lot. And in 1 Corinthians 16 verse 22, it says, if you love not the Lord Christ, you are anathema maranatha. You know, nowadays, when we want to preach, we only preach maranatha. Maranatha. Lord Jesus, come. That's not the scripture. It says, if you love not the Lord, you are anathema
Maranatha.
What it means in the sanctuary, when a sanctuary material becomes accursed and rejected, they put it on the shelf and just hang it there. They don't use it anymore. It's accursed. So what is telling us, if you don't love the Lord, God hangs you on the shelf waiting for when he will come back. But you are already an accursed material. So when God has a demand and you run, you are not wise. What you did is that you traded eternity in time. Let me show you what many people call love. So you can censor yourself. There are five types of love that men engage in. And because they are not taught kingdom, they think they are loving God. But God has already probed your intention before your action. He said, I, the Lord, I search the heart. I test the reins to give to every man as his way should be. He's not moved by your action unless he's sure of your intention. The first thing men call love is love for the world. So when you see a man laboring, when you see a man struggling, even in prayer, find out why he's pursuing God so much. And then he will tell you, my neighbor that we started together, can you imagine now he has two cars? Lord, what have I done to you? What have I done? Why? The man that God chose to respond to when he asked why, when he came, he said, you are darkening counsel by words without knowledge. So every time you ask why, the reason is because you didn't journey to the foundation of the earth to find out the wisdom that network the foundation. If you do, you will not ask why. You will say, God, help me. You know, people don't like kingdom. But we have made up our mind, we will say it. And we will keep saying it. You know, if I begin to teach mysteries, people begin to jump and shout. When I started, I wanted to touch some things. Everybody is shouting. Mysteries are not read. They are committed to servants. He said, we are servants of God. Therefore, we are stewards of the mysteries of Christ. You don't read a mystery. It's a disclosure. So sometimes when we share it and people begin to shout, we lock it up. And then we show them the journey into mystery. He said, love not the world. He said, they that love the world, the love of the Father is not in them. He didn't say we not. He said it's not. It's already not in them. Meanwhile, what is the implication in eternity? In 1 John chapter 4, verse 17, he said, perfect love casteth out fear. For we know that we will be bold before him on the day of judgment. Why? Because as he is, so are we. There is a love dimension we have entered. The reason I will approach the throne of God bold is not because I fasted. It's because I love the Lord. And one of the ways to verify that love, he said, is when you obey his commandment and when you give your substance. That is the sign that your heart is with God. It's not how many scriptures you can quote. When God makes demand, are you there? He said, what is in the world? The lust of the flesh. The lust of the eyes. The pride of life. Most of the activities that Christians carry out is motivated by lust. I was sharing with Daddy yesterday, and I've shared with many ministers. is a strange, it's so strange, some of the Christianity we practice. When you want to do something in church that everybody sees, and they will call them up and say what they gave, people will give in millions. But when you do what is not seen, nobody will give. The action is right, but the motivation is wrong. So he said, even though it looks spiritual, it's still in the world. When you say, let's pray, the person on the altar is praying like a trumpet. But the moment he hands over the microphone and is no longer visible, he sits down and he stops praying. Brother A, pray. When you collect the microphone, ends. Pride of life. When you say we are in a retreat and they are not recording, nobody is praying. But the moment you bring camera, because they know it to be streamed on Facebook, and we say it's revival. We are playing. We are playing. If it's not public, activity ends. We don't know the kingdom. I told them, an intercessor is not a man that prays long. Even though intercessors pray long, an intercessor is a man that can isolate the burden in the heart of God. So it's the burden in the heart of God that fuels his prayer enterprise. He said Noah picked a frequency in the heart of God that seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter will not see. How did he enter there? He's a man of the altar. So when he ascends the altar, he's traveling into the heart of God. And when he catches that body, he can carry that body for 3 weeks. The lust of the flesh. And most times what we call gospel is to pamper the lust of the flesh, to pamper the lust of the eyes, and to pamper the pride of life. We don't know kingdom. If you tell somebody to do something that has no personal gain, nobody will do it. When you see people gather around a place, there is gain attached to it. When you see men committed to something, there is gain. Is there anything wrong in receiving returns? No. But if that becomes motivation, then kingdom has been lost. And all our reward will be in time, no matter how spiritual that activity looks. He said, don't be like the Pharisees. They pray at street corners. They pray for long with many repetitions so that men will be seen. They will be seen of men. He said, you have already received your reward. How can I do something as spiritual as prayer and I receive my reward on it? It's a wasted life. So the first thing we do, and we call the love of God, is actually lost, powered by our love for this world. So when we bring men to the kingdom, we censor their motives and their intentions, because the Lord searches the heart and he tests the reins. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 3, he said, anybody who doesn't know God, anybody who doesn't love God, he said, God doesn't know him. So God doesn't know you because you are born again. God knows you because you love him. And the acid test for love is self-denial. Self-denial is what motivates our walk in the kingdom. I can carry out a test here now, you'll be sure. If we say, let's pray for marriages, let's pray for businesses, this building will collapse. Everybody's voice will be like a trumpet. But if I say, let's pray for Nigeria,
I see the oil of wealth. The oil of wealth is coming. Amen. Amen.
It shows where our heart is. Meanwhile, maybe what is in the heart of the Father are souls that should be won in this new decade. But all your plan doesn't include any soul winning. So you don't even know what is in the heart of God. Rather, you want to upload what is in your heart into the heart of God. We don't upload into God, we download God. Because when you download God, both your problem and the problem of God will be met. But when you upload yourself into God, it's corruption. This is what he said they should disciple the poor. Did you not notice that all of Jesus' disciples died? What type of discipleship is that? He said, in this world, you will have many tribulations. I thought we came for breakthrough. When did tribulation come into the business? Because when he's discipling men, he's considering thrones in eternity. And he told them, you will sit with me on 12 thrones to judge the 12 tribes of Israel. Most times, the reason our discipleship is faulty is because those on the altar don't know the agenda of God. They don't know. If I tell you, what is your slogan? What is your goal? What is your theme for this year? All of it will surround around self. Self-preservation. Self-exaltation. Self-glorification. Self-aggrandizement. And we say we are agents of the kingdom. If you love not the Lord, you are anathema. Maranatha. The second dimension of love that men practice and call the love of God is self. And it's one of the dark prophecies for the last day. Love of self. The implication of the love of the world is this. Is that it will darken your understanding. He said in 1 Corinthians 1 verse 12, we have not received the spirit that is of this world, but the spirit of God, whereby we know the things that are freely given to us by God. He said, but the carnal man, the natural man, he receiveth not the things of God, neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. Why? Because the love of the world darkens your understanding. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 3, he said, if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. That's why when you talk kingdom, men are not interested, because they can't see beyond themselves. If it does not translate to direct blessing, they can't see it. Meanwhile, Paul said, if only in this life we have hope, we are of all men most miserable. There is a realm beyond time. We are only pilgrims on earth. Imagine you are traveling to Lagos and then you cross on Nechatua Saba and then you stop, you begin to dance. You don't know your destination. And it's a sign that we are small. How much do you need to eat? How much do you need to drink? He said, that is the way of the hidden. You need to hear when God defines things. The definitions of God are not the same with the definition of man. The way God defines the hidden is that they love themselves. So all their pursuit is for self. He said, not even Solomon in all his riches is as beautiful as the lilies. He said, but they don't strive for what to eat and drink. He said, but you seek first the kingdom. The strategy of blessing is that your blessing is an addition.
Because we don't know the power of God. That's why we pursue things.
He said, when you pursue the kingdom, things pursue you.
That's how God designed the equation.
But we turn from God and we pursue things. He said to Abraham, walk before me and be thou perfect. And when Abraham was old, he said, and Abraham was old and well stricken in age, and the Lord had blessed him in all things. You reduce the quality of your life when you begin to pursue things. Because that thing you are pursuing, that is your prayer point, somebody else can give it without thinking. In 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 2, he began to tell us the nature of Christians that will exist in the last day. I told myself I will never fulfill negative prophecies. He said, in the last days, men shall be lovers of themselves. I was with Evangelist Sunday Ogwuche 2 days ago, and he said, in the last days, it will be easy to be a prophet. It will be easy to be an apostle. It will be easy to be an evangelist. But it will be very hard to be a Christian. It will be very hard to be like Christ. Because the love of many shall wax cold. Iniquity shall abound. Darkness shall be in the heart of men. And what did he call iniquity? I will exalt my throne and be like the Most High. I. Iniquity is living for self. And on the strength of that, violating the ordinances of God. This is why the discernment of many have become dark. A herbalist is wearing suit, but Christians can't discern. Because the love of this world darkens your understanding. It darkens your heart. And when a man of understanding speaks, they say, men, they are fighting people. Stop fighting men. They are saving your soul. If they don't have to preach what you need, which gospel will they preach to you? That's why our African preachers can't break out of Africa into Europe. Because we only preach need. And when you come to a country where men don't have such need, you have no gospel for them. In the days of the fathers, they pushed back Islam. Islam was at their boundaries, and men invaded Islam and won them over. We don't even have the power to try it anymore. Instead, they are infiltrating our borders. We have not only stopped moving them backward, we are retrogressing, and they are taking their hold in our lands because of self-love. So your governors can afford to sell the land and give them hectares to build mosques and other kinds of things. And they are church leaders. They are deacons. And when they come to church, instead of rebuking them, bishops kneel down to beg them. Because we don't know the office of a prophet. He said, and Uzziah began to reign at the age of 16, and he sought the Lord after Zacharias, that had understanding in the visions of God. And for 50 years, one prophet kept a king at the altar. They had power with God. They didn't need money and chiefs to be prophets. They had the oracles of God. All our leaders are in church, but our land is in darkness. They were not taught kingdom.
They grew up in church, but they didn't know kingdom. And now that they are empowered, the beast of reckless wickedness have risen in their hearts. And we can't talk to them anymore. We don't know kingdom. Even fathers, the moment their children begin to touch money, they can't correct them. Not in Israel. If you like, be 50 years old, you will kneel down before your father and your mother for him to bless you. The Lord bless you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance above you. And the Lord give you peace. If he doesn't bless you, you are cursed. But there's no kingdom. We gather in church to excite ourselves. And we call it revival. Most of the people in leadership today, when they were boys in church, some of the preachers had become preachers. But they can't correct them. Because if you didn't teach them truth, when they are empowered, you can't approach them with it. The reason our inheritance with God is diminishing is because self-love have taken the place of God. In the days of the patriarch, men like Samuel could tell Saul to the face, "The Lord have rejected you." If you like, kill him. It's not a factor. He cannot but dispense the oracles of God. And when Saul wanted to use his military might, Samuel had a technology that was superior to bows and arrows. He said in Nayoth Ramah, there was a frequency, a radar in Nayoth Ramah. He sent troops of soldiers. When they entered that radar, they began to prophesy. Saul himself came. He said he prophesied naked until it was morning. Those are the men that he said he rebuked kings for their sakes. Touch not my anointed. Do my prophets no harm, because I am the Lord that confirmeth the words of my servant. I perform the counsels of my messengers. They are puppets in the hands of God, not men. He said, if I be a servant of man, I am not a servant of God. The altars of self have been elevated in our hearts. And even the spiritual things we do is for self-aggrandizement. The third dimension of love among mortals today is pleasure. So bad that even widows that should seek the face of God are living for pleasure. And he said, him that liveth for pleasure is dead, even while he's alive. So when a spirit wants to find out who is alive, it's not the man breathing. Even the goat breathes oxygen. The man who is alive in the curriculum of the spirit is a man that lives above pleasure. So long as you are under the pillar of pleasure, he said, you are already dead. Spirits don't define things like mortals. You are a heathen if you pursue things and not the kingdom. You are dead if you live for pleasure and not for God. But he said, Enoch walked with God, and he was not, because God took him. There are men that walk with God. Where we are coming now is a dark season, and there are dimensions in Christ we must step into for us to survive. I traveled to Ghana last week. To go to Ghana and come back, I did COVID test 4 times. in the days to come, you will need a vaccinated passport to travel. And they don't care. Meanwhile, records reveal that almost all the vaccines being designed tamper with the human DNA. But nobody cares. Do you know the implication? The essence of man that makes him walk with God is his soul. If your DNA is altered, the information that goes to your soul will be misinterpreted. So they can alter your DNA. And when they say love, you will think love is sex. And the doctrine of immorality will fail naturally. So it will be a waste to preach, because the DNA has been altered. It's called genetic engineering. I started preaching it since 2018. Four Wings of Revival. I told them genetic re-engineering to alter the DNA of man. He can't know God anymore. Men will be in church having sex. You can't talk to them. What do you mean? Is anything wrong with it? If you say God loves you, they interpret it as sex. What do you do? DNA have been altered. You don't know the intelligence that went in place for the DNA to be framed. And Nigerian government is the first that have made payment for vaccine. I've already budgeted billions. Vaccine that have not yet been tested to know the side effect, to know the long-term effect. They know nothing but corruption. Because we don't have apostles in the Senate. We have hungry and greedy men that were raised from the church. The men in the Senate, they didn't come from the bush. They came from the church. But they don't know the kingdom. And then we think, when we prophesy to people, from January to December, we are helping them. We are setting up the destiny of our children. Very soon, you can't buy drugs unless you have a vaccine. You can't go to the market to buy unless you have a vaccine. This is why the dimension of Enoch must return. Because the Enoch generation is a generation that cannot be bound by nature. It's a generation that have journeyed out of self into God, because Enoch was not. There is no longer Enoch. God have dominated Enoch. So when you look upon Enoch, you see God. That was why Enoch can step into the wind and travel by the wings of the Spirit. So if they say you must travel with a vaccinated passport, tell them, wait for me, I'm coming to Canada tomorrow. And when it's time for the meeting, kakataka pakataka, and you step into Canada. You step into Canada. You don't need a plane to travel, because men that walk with Lord God, one of their heritage is that they are not. It's the Enoch dimension. And that's what Jesus prophesied. As the wind bloweth, thou listest not from whence it cometh or where it goeth, so are they that are born by the Spirit of God. I told them in Ogbo, when Jesus was multiplying bread, he wasn't necessarily doing a miracle. He was teaching our generation how to survive. Because the day cometh, and if they say you must bow to idol to buy bread, you say, don't worry, I have one bread in my house. It's enough. And when you come, you take it and say, I give you thanks, oh Father. Divide the bread, and you will eat the bread for 10 years. This is why, beyond prophesying, we teach man kingdom. Because there are virgin dimensions in God that mortals have not stepped into, but is the heritage of our generation. When Philip was done from Samaria, he said the Spirit of God caught him up, and he appeared in the wilderness. When he finished, the Spirit of God caught him up.
what awaits us. Who told you you are blessed when they say you have bread? No, there is a place in Christ where men multiply bread. And it's not a miracle, it's a life. That was what Moses knew. With a staff, he brought down Egypt, but it was not enough. He said, show me thy glory. And he said, there's a place by my side, by the cleft of the rock, and I will put you there, and all of my goodness will pass by. And when Moses came out, he became a god. Kingdom is not disadvantage. It's to cause you to step into the name of our God. It's God Yodhei Vavhei, the one who was, the one who is, and the one who is to come. It's to step into the dimensions of the glory. A generation will be lost unless we return to the kingdom. It's the generation of the Enoch. That's why I said in the last day, Enoch will return. Enoch is not returning as a person. He's returning as a generation. Because when he said Elijah will return, Elijah returned and he said, in the days of John, he became a generation. A time will come when, because you want to go on mission, you will divide yourself. In Genesis chapter 18, verse 14, he said, Abraham went for the battle of the great kings. And he said, he took 318 servants of his household. And he said, Abraham divided himself. And one Abraham became 319 Abraham. A time will come, you will be in your shop selling, but you will be preaching in Afghanistan. That's the way of the kingdom. Men become invincible because they have stepped out of flesh. Flesh is a limitation. Your greatest potential is not in the flesh, it's on the mountains of God. That is why he said, who shall ascend unto the mountains of God? Who shall stand upon his holy hills? They that are of a pure heart and of a clean heart. Because it's a place where the sons of Jacob shall appear, and they will judge the mountains of Esau. It's to teach Esau the ways of God. We are full of flesh and we think we are being helped. You won't see Christians where they teach the word of God. You see them where they prophesy them bread and wine. That's why they remain babes. Self has crippled a generation. But when God wants to deal with flesh, he takes you to Golgotha, the place of the skull. That's where flesh is decimated and you are crucified. So the one that lives is no longer you, but Christ. That's what Paul said. I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Why? I have been crucified. I know the way to Golgotha. I know. He said, I, John, I was in the isle called Patmos for the tribulation and the testimony of God. I was in the spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard a voice like a trumpet. And as I turned, he entered into Alpha Omega. When he returned, he became a god. Flesh is a limitation. You don't know who you are until you give up flesh. In Zechariah 2:13, he said, be silent, O flesh, that the God of glory will ascend from his tabernacle. What is the tabernacle of God? You are the one. But you will lock God there until flesh keeps quiet. Did you not read that Jesus didn't say pray for the sick, touch them? Because God flows out of you like rivers of living waters. Out of the ashes of my dying today, I see the breaking of a brand new day, in which the name of the Lord alone is glorified. As in the breaking of a brand new day. You don't lose when you die. When you die, you step into the resurrection power. When all of us are known after the flesh, then we are disadvantaged. That's why Paul says, henceforth, know we no man after the flesh. What is the dimension of God that you have touched? In the angelic realm, you don't have a place until you represent the dimension. Michael is the strength of God. Gabriel is the wisdom of God. What is your dimension? Even demons know men that carry dimensions. You say, Paul, I know. Jesus, I know. Who art thou? Out of the ashes of my dying, today I see the breaking of a brand new day, in which the name of the Lord alone is glorified. I see the breaking of a brand new day. The devil will come first to lure you, but it's a lie. What he wants to give you is what you already have in God. He told Jesus, I will give you fame, I will give you power, I will give you influence. Jesus said no. And the moment Jesus returned, he said he returned in the power of the Spirit. There was power awaiting him. The devil came to cut and to sabotage the process. He said his fame went abroad. There was fame waiting for him. The devil only wanted to sabotage the process. You want to pray? Way forward. The fourth type of love is love for men and women. He said, Solomon loved the Lord. God did many mighty things with Solomon until he said, and suddenly Solomon loved strange women. 1 Kings 11 verse 1. The fifth type of love is the love of money. 1 Timothy 6:10. The love of money is the root of all evil. So if you love money, evil has its roots in you. That's how spirit defines things. But when kingdom comes, it uproots these five types of love. And it plants the love of God in your heart. And so he said, and the love of God is shed abroad in our heart by his Spirit. Prayer point this morning. Lord, give me the baptism of love. Go ahead and pray. Baptize me with love. Yeah.